welcome to Rishabhati Baghi and Nalini Pai. Unfortunately, Shubha Shinde couldn't be here for personal reasons, but you know, I'm very pleased to introduce. Yes, I believe.
I'll start with a disclaimer. Although I had initially titled the paper A Critique of Women's Srinivas's Concept of Sanskritization, as I started writing, it turned out that I had to focus more on the gender of the Ambedkarite subject rather than the specific concept of Sanskritization, which I have dealt here, but it is no longer the main focus of my paper. So a more apt title would be The Gender of the Ambedkarite Subject, and you, as I read, you would know why it is so. So I'm starting the paper. Towards the end of Sharan Kumar Limbale's last novel, The Hindu, the protagonist Milind Kamble undergoes an experience of emasculation as he submits to the whims of two upper caste goons and is coerced into accepting their humiliating offer. Indeed, the narrative is a record of numerous instances in the protagonist's life, who is an organic intellectual of sorts, when he compromises with the ideals of the movement and fails to live up to the image of an ideal Ambedkarite. These are instances when his courage fails him, or his idealism gives way to jealousy, petty self-interest, or uncontrollable sexual desire. He cheats on his wife, fails to resist the rape of a Dalit woman, drinks with the rapists, accepts bribes, and escapes the field of action. Every time he fails to perform the role of a husband, father, politician, and an activist, he experiences a sense of loss of honor. Every time he experiences a loss of honor as he fails to curb his instincts, he experiences humiliation. What needs to be emphasized here is the fact that this humiliation of the Dalit man causes or is experienced as emasculation. As his sense of being an ideal Ambedkarite subject is threatened, his identity as a man also undergoes crisis. It is this crisis that ultimately forces his metamorphosis into a woman. Failure to be an Ambedkarite subject and the associated experiences of humiliation emasculates the Dalit man. It turns him into a woman. Limbale's narrative is of seminal importance. This aspect of caste gender violence, it also participates in constructing the figure of the Dalit woman as one who is incapable of resistance of any sort. Mohan Satyagraha of 1927 and the conversion to Buddhism in 1956. Considering the fact that the book is part of personal effort of two Dalit women writers who have not received institutional support, and that it builds up narratives or testimonials of those women on whose lives records are not easily available, measure of the selves by using public languages and meaning of our culture. Through this observation, I am trying to draw your attention to the fact that these interviews construct a particular public image of the self of the Dalit woman. Whatever crises in gender roles occur, they are occasioned by the Dalit women's claiming of the public space. Through this image, in the narratives of the women, spoken in the first person singular, the figure that repeatedly comes up is the morally righteous, courageous, and self-sacrificing woman who has worked in the service of the community, leaving aside her personal need and desire. In one respect, the focus on heroic sacrifice of women is a recurrent trope in narratives of resistance movement in India, whether it is the nationalist movement or the left movements. For example, Srila Rao has pointed out in a study of the Naxalbari movement that women constructed themselves by drawing on cultural and historical constructions of heroic femininity. It became one of the important images with which women could relate or draw upon in order to make sense of herself. Jashodhara Bakshi has critically looked at the figure of the sacrificing revolutionary mother that has dominated the Naxalites, even in works of writers like Mahashweta Devi. In contrast, the three figures that dominate the narratives of Dalit women are the figures of the public speaker, noted for her fierce speech and confident demeanor, the teacher who battles caste discrimination in order to facilitate education of Dalit girls, and the Buddhist victims, where they are present as victimized mothers or lovers. Here the scope is much larger. Ambedkar himself had focused on the public role of Dalit women, and it is in the public sphere that these women enact their autonomy. We must remember here that historically Dalit women have had a fraught relationship with the public space. Given their roles As laborers who have publicly worked for the maintenance of subalterna villages or habitation, Dalit women, as women whose bodies are available for the society, have always been public women of some sort, unlike their upper caste counterparts who have faced confinement in the private sphere. The former's publicness and visibility with all the markers of caste subordination have affirmed that distinction between the subalterna society and the Dalit society. Their publicness had been a marker of the subalterna men's control of their bodies and the concomitant inability of Dalit men to control the Dalit women's body. Thus, many anti-caste resistants often make their mark in the society by stalling all kinds. Enabled by her role as a public speaker, educationist woman, holding a sari in one hand and a paper on the other hand, from which she reads out to the assembled public, is the image of an autonomous being. Moreover, importance is the figure of the social worker and Bhikshuni, or the Dalit woman, who converts to Buddhism and leads the life of a Buddhist ascetic. As social worker and Bhikshuni, the Dalit women also challenge the patriarchal norms that govern their personal relationships. For instance, the activist Shantabai Bale Rao decided to leave her husband, as what she says, she did not get on with him. I find marriage quite provocative. There is no attempt at justification of a separation, nor there is any narrative of possible domestic violence she might have faced. I would not see this as some sort of claiming education on part of Dalit women turns many discriminatory social practices. Interestingly, it will be a desire for more education that would create a crisis in their domesticity, a crisis that would continue to trouble their marital relationship. On the one hand, Pawar's educational achievement would be initially supported by her husband, but when her degree would serve to delve into the question of companionate marriage. It has already been pointed out by Sharmila Rege that for many upper caste women, companionate marriage provided an marriage while requiring the woman to be modern also necessitated that her recasting or refashioning be done in order to meet the requirements of the new man or the Vajraluk. Compatibility with the man educated in Western thought necessitated that this new modern woman be educated and cultured. However, her education should not and most often did not exceed the education of her husband. If the educated, she does not attribute it to any one specific source or person. Rather, what seems to be triggering the desire for more education is also disturbs the private. Her husband repeatedly chastises her for her neglecting their children and ignoring the domestic concern. Moreover, the gender division of the labor remains unchanged in their family for a long time. What is subverted to her education is the invisibilization of Dalit women in the public space. The private remains the site of hostility and quarrels where compatibility or companionship is rare and distant. It would be interesting to point out here that the very concept of home or the private sphere that is necessary for the conjugality or companionate marriage is determined by their location as Dalits in the society. Thus, one of the recurrent problems that the young couple faces is the repeated eviction from their rented apartments after the revelation of their caste status. If during the colonial period, home or the private sphere was the space where the upper caste Hindu male could enact his autonomy, that is hardly available for the Dalit man or woman. Like the public habitants could not gaze out, symbolizes the predicament of Dalit conjugality, where privacy is forever denied by their social status. Privacy, like dignity or education, needs to be earned and claimed. The construction of home as a space of shelter, seclusion, autonomy and distinct cultural identity that upper caste narratives of self-formation necessitate is absent here. Home is the place where the Dalits are yet to assert their autonomy. This is sharply evident in the nameplates of some middle class Dalit homes who are forced to take up upper caste surnames in order to live with the upper caste neighbors. Their sexuality are perceived as factor of the newly acquired status of Dalit men. Upward mobility in this scheme of things restricts the freedom of Dalit women, and Dalit men become the ultimate arbiter of their life choices. Urmila Pawar's narrative offers a different picture of upward mobility. As noted in the previous section, the very notion of a private sphere that is well guarded from the public is a factor of mobility. The home or the domesticity is acquired only after some social mobility. Moreover, in the narrative, the home is built on the labor of both the man and the woman. Most importantly, upward mobility through education of the Dalit woman does not reinforce patriarchy. Rather, it enables the Dalit woman to be a writer. Very significantly, Her education and feminist consciousness also makes her accept and fight for her daughter's sexual or conjugal choice. She does not hesitate to go against her husband's and the society's will to fight for this that often debunk norms of Hinduism or patriarchy. Urmila Pawar writes that she wore the Mangal Sutra, the Brahminical patriarchal symbol of a married woman, in order to appease her relatives. Similarly, their daughters' marriages were also held according to Brahminical rituals. However, if our focus remains on the ritual symbols, we may miss the layers of conflicts or uneasiness that accompany these rituals. It is important to appreciate the way motherhood has been represented in the autobiography. Sharmila Rege has pointed out that the representation of women is in most Dalit autobiographies have confined them to the roles of victimized mothers who toil hard for their children's survival, the self of the mother, of the woman. Instead of self-annihilation, as she mourns the death of the two men, her being undergoes a transformation. Judith Butler writes that the mourning has to do with herself agreeing to undergo transformation. What I would want to emphasize is the deliberate project of self-transformation. Through this deliberate project of self-transformation, Power takes on through the reading and translation of Buddhist texts. It is this phase of life when she works as a reader and translation of Buddhist thought that she can transcend her role as a mother or wife and takes on the role of a writer. The act of translation grants her autonomy, just as Buddhist philosophy strengthens her. This again is another instance when the undertaking picture of the home and the private sphere. The autonomous identity of the Dalit man or woman is dependent on the projects they take up in the public sphere and redefine their public presence. The home is an extension of the public without any sharp division. Although the division is desired, the very creation of the division requires the public presence of the Dalit woman in the form of a labor. These narratives, although limited in number, reveal the inadequacies of the thesis of division of inner and outer sphere in the understanding of Indian modernity.
Wonderful. So now we will listen to the second paper and final paper on this panel. Now, can I please ask Nalinipai, where would you like to stay? Would you stand there? Or please? Nalinipai to present her paper, which is called Standing Up for Herself.
Very easily accessible thanks to the number of translation of books from regional languages. In the recent past, writing by Dalit women has been the area that has garnered a lot of attention. In the hierarchy, the Dalit man is seen as suppressed and the Dalit woman is seen as doubly marginalized. However, works by Bama, a Dalit woman writer from Tamil Nadu, and Gogu Shamla, a Dalit writer from Telangana, seem to suggest otherwise. Both these writers look at the Dalit girl or woman as someone who stands up for her rights and puts up a fight against injustices meted out to her. Bama's women characters show remarkable courage in the face of adversity and even look for ways to save their men folk who are in trouble sometimes. One can see that in her full-length novel titled Manma. While Bama's Sangati shows women as custodians of a vibrant Kerala woman ask for her land. Shamala also showcases women as performers who sing and enact ancient stories showcasing the legends and myths associated with castes like the Mala and the Madiga. One can see that in the story titled Jambava's Lineage. This paper attempts to look at select works of both the above mentioned writers and see how they challenge popular perceptions of the Dalit woman as victim. Dalit literature and writing by Dalits is today an important area of research, vast and varied. The first of these phases was during the colonial period when the European rulers raised their voices against the social evils prevailing in Indian society. The second phase was when freedom fighters merged the freedom movement and the women's movement. The feeling was that the suffering of all women was essentially the same. The downside to this approach was, however, that the oppression of the Dalit woman was not looked at and given the attention that it needed to be given. Sharmila Rege notes in her article that there was a masculinization and a savanization of womanhood leading to the classical exclusion of Dalit womanhood. Rege in her article, Dalit women and therefore could not speak on their behalf or even articulate their oppression adequately. This called for a separate group to be formed so as to take up the cause of Dalit women. In Guru's own words, Dalit women's claim to talk differently assumes certain positions. It assumes that the social location of the speaker will be more or less stable. Therefore, talking differently can be treated as genuine and there is no help available. She devises a way to get out of the situation on her own.
I've taken up certain works of both Gogu Shamla and Bama in order to illustrate this. Tamil's book of short stories titled Father May Be an Elephant and Mother Only a Small Basket, but the story recounts the exploits of a young girl who's about 12, reaching her father's fields early and watering them. She manages to water all her fields before the laborer attached to the landlord arrives. As a result, he has less water for the landlord's fields. The landlord gets to know and decides to teach Tataki a lesson. He hides in the neighboring fields and pulls her into the neighboring field and tries to molest her sexually. He falls back and manages to escape. In this story, one sees that far from being a victim, the young girl Tataki actually gives back as good as she gets and also manages to escape without too much harm being done to her. In the absence of physical strength, Tataki has to rely on her presence of mind and sharpness of mind to think up some way to escape. I quote from the text, "You are a small girl, are you?" The opinions given by the landlord are in keeping with the feudal society that he lives in. He asks why Tataki has come to the fields like a man, tending to the fields, handling heavy farm tools, diverting water and doing hard manual labor is considered a man's job. If at all the woman is to be at the field, she should carry out tasks like weeding, cutting grass and clearing the field. As far as subaltern castes are concerned, they all go to work regardless of whether they are children, women or men. Men do all kinds of work relating to agriculture, from the sowing to the harvesting. His ire is as much against Tataki doing what she wants, does as a young girl, as against the water resources being inadequate for his fields due to Tataki's taking the water for her fields. Also, people of these castes cannot afford to sit at home just because they are on the verge of physical puberty. The landlord is speaking from a totally physical as well as an ideological location when he says that the Mala and Madiga don't even know that girls are to be among other castes than among the Mala and Madiga. He perceives her as a woman who is in their boxes, and they have to do that because it is the money that he gives her that drives the cart. It is because of this that she even stands and sits according to his orders. The narrator goes on to say that both men and women in these castes go out and earn. Most of the men never give their wages to the women. The family runs on the women's wages. If she is running, that's only very late in the evening. The women in the landlord home spend their lives fetching and caring for their men and therefore have very little say in the running of the house. The subaltern caste is in a position to assert herself. Sangati speaks, stood up to the landlord's selfish ways. He had put up a barbed wire all around his well. Nevertheless, Shanmuga Kiravi bathed not once but many times in that well. One fine day, he caught Kiravi red-handed and questioned her. She spat into the well, saying that the water in the well is salty. He complains to the headman and she gets into trouble. After that, she decides to teach him a lesson. One day, the landlord whips a child from the Dalit community because she dares to touch his water. In order to teach him a lesson, she relieves herself in that pot when he isn't there. She goes around saying that he complained that a Paraichi swam in his well and contaminated the water. Now, she says, let him partake of her urine. Here we see the open revolt after seemingly polite words from the Dalit woman. This kind of a person, according to the narrator, is needed once in a while if the women have to get even basic respect from upper caste men. Shamila's volume also contains, but why shouldn't the Bainla woman ask for her land? A very poignant story of a very brave Bainla woman demanding her land from the upper caste landlord. Sayama belongs to the Bainla caste, which is the priestly caste of the Madiga. Among the upper caste, she is seen as a prostitute, and among the Madiga, she is seen as a priestess. A contradiction. Soothsayer and is trained to conduct the worship and officiate as priestess. The story opens with Sayama and other subaltern caste members assembling. She angrily asks the Dora to make his own daughter a jogini and says that she will pay the girl a fee. She pounds her fist on the table in front of the Dora and suddenly appears like the deity Uradamma herself and even pushes away a Sabanda elder who comes in between her and the Dora. When one of her brothers is carrying her away, she threatens, "If you don't vacate my land, I will sacrifice you. Only then will the curse be lifted from the village." The Dora and the Patel look at the caste elders and asked how they could sit and do nothing when a Bainla woman banged her fist on the table and asked for her land. "Are you men or do you wear bangles?" This utterance is significant as they are not only against a Baindla woman asking for her land, they are also aghast that a Baindla woman has done so and gotten away with it, cursing them all the time. The Baindla woman is not only powerless because she is from the lower caste, but also because she is a woman. By asking for her land, she has undermined the authority of the upper castes and upset the rigid caste hierarchy. She has, according to them, done something absolutely outrageous. The above scathing comment also points to the fact that the caste elders are not men enough. They do not possess manly qualities so as to be able to put down the rebellion of one woman. According to the Dora, a Baindla woman should be easy to take the land and has receipts to prove that it once belonged to her paternal aunt. Encroached upon by the Dora's cousin, she states all of this in a very matter-of-fact way. It is interesting to note that the land as well as the right to conduct the rituals that the Jogini does is passed down from her aunt practice. The Jogini is a powerful person as she has access to the demands what is rightfully hers. Besides a direct confrontation, there are other ways in which the Mala and Madiga castes negotiate daily crises. Shambhala's story, Jambava's lineage, is one such story. This narrative recounts the lives of a troupe of performers who go from place to place and act out the myths connecting her. The upper castes back then would be a lot worse. They would throw money at her as she performed. When she bent down to pick up the money, they would throw more at her back. Some people would pin currency notes together and put them around her neck. "It is the advance that we are offering," they would say, leering. Elama explained to the little Sinna Elama, some higher caste people would call her names. They called her slut, cunning and haughty. She would tell them that she is like their younger sister and that she is sharp and active thanks to their good wishes and blood. Cultural legacy almost entirely on her own. "I take care of you by teaching you your history and culture," she says. She thinks of her performance as a way of educating people about their own culture and origin. It is worth noting that the troupe is led by Elama, a woman. In other castes, it's usually a man who puts up these performances, and sometimes even women's roles are played by men traditionally. In a lot of ways, the women of the Madiga community and other subaltern castes are more liberated than their upper caste counterparts. It is only through oppression that the higher caste, that the Dalit woman suffers. She also has to suffer abuse from, it is not only oppression from higher castes that the after this wailing and spewing a volley of abuse. "How dare you kick me, you low life? How dare you pull my hair? Instead of drinking toddy every day, why don't you drink your son's urine? Why don't you drink my monthly blood?" She follows this tirade up by lifting up her sari. At this, her husband walks off shouting. The women who have been watching all this comment on how shameless the woman is for having lifted up her sari. She turns on them and tells them that the only way she will get out of this alive is by shaming her husband roundly for hurting her. She dares him to go and fight a man who is his equal, indicating that she is not up to him in terms of physical strength, and this she more than makes up for by letting forth a volley of choicest abuse. It is interesting to note that the voice of the wrong woman rising in anger and pain is often violent and sexually explicit. And Lakshmi Holmstrom, the translator of Bama Sangati, in the introduction to Sangati, gives us what Bama herself suggests as the reason for this kind of violence. Bama suggests that the only way of escaping violence for a woman sometimes is obscene and violent language. Also, the lives of these women are so bereft of pleasurable experience that no other words come out of their mouths. Besides, it may be the result of a certain amount of internalizing of a patriarchy based on sexual dominance and power. The other aspect of the language here of the women is earthy and vigorous. Besides, the language is close to the proverbs, rhymes and folk songs. There are special songs and dances for every occasion. They alone know what they have undergone and they are therefore best qualified to talk about it. She refuses to go, saying that she wants nothing to do with him, and he flies into a rage, to which she replies, "I will do whatever I want to. Who are you to question me? Did I give birth to the children without your help? Try and bring them up." She retorts angrily to his abuse and is dragged by the hair and at one point hurts her head. She walks straight to the police station and has him arrested. The women speak of how arrogant Ponnuthai has become. Also, the men speak of how useless it is to have a mustache if one cannot live up to the standards of a real man. Mukandi comes to speak to Ponnuthai's father, saying that he is intending to remarry and that she should take her children back with her and go away. Ponnuthai listens to her father pacifying her husband and replies that she neither wants him nor his children, and she argues that after all there is no law that dictates that only women should look after the children born from a man. References to male superiority include qualities like being able to control one's wife and facial hair like mustache being the mark of a man's honor. Also, men are shown as expecting the woman to stand by them no matter what. They are naturally aghast when the woman fights back and takes steps to punish them. The weapon they then wield is physical and verbal abuse, and lastly, the threat of taking another woman as wife. Guru, in his article, Dalit Women Talk Differently, speaks of a hierarchy of educated Dalit women being better off than their less educated or unlettered counterparts. They are asserting their rights and creating an identity for themselves. Thank you.
Both of you, I think that was a lovely way to open the conference. Are there any questions? I have a few, but I would like to keep
getting the Hindu code bill. So in talking about the gender of the Ambedkarite subject, you've confined your work to texts, but you've also referred to critics, I mean other books, you know, like Srila Roy, which is not very directly relevant. So I was just wondering why you left out Ambedkar at all.
Not mentioning Ambedkar, I was looking at certain very specific issues here, like the question of conjugality and the question of the home or the crisis in gender norms. And of course, but even though I have not mentioned Ambedkar's works directly, but I have referred to, when I was talking about mobility, the idea of mobility through education or conversion, these are like, and Ambedkar himself addressed women and asked them to get educated or educate their children or convert. These are, even though I have not mentioned them, he is there obviously. And Srila Roy's work, even though she is talking about the women of the Naxalbari movement, I think I used her because in, that's why I used her. Her work.
That says she's a woman, particularly a sexual being. And do you think that this kind of looking at Dalit women as a sexual being could be well equated with the concept of empire of the Sabarna system, and when the woman we're talking about, she strikes back to the landlord, could be well equated with a kind of empire strikes back in case of an already existing Sabarna system.
You know, taking into account that theory, yes, what you're saying, in a sense, we can look at it like that. But I chose these stories because they show a pattern. And as early as 1994, we have Bama actually fashioning out a Dalit feminism, which Holmstrom kind of hails as being something of a first. And that is why I took both, of course, Gogu Shamala is slightly later, but it is, and of course, it's written in such a lively, you know, very...
Sorry, by the lines that you just quoted, I got a sense that there is a certain type of stereotyping at play, you know, even like Dalit woman constantly sexualized. So could you just comment, do you think there is a certain narrative type which these texts fall into? If you could just comment on that.
Oppression of Dalit, of the protagonist, by... Dalit up of the protagonists by other Dalit women. Can you elaborate on that phenomena, please, in the Q&A?
Which particular story are you referring?
Rakamma, for example, when she lifts her sari, it's the other women who say that, who comment on it when her husband leaves.
Yeah.
Can you elaborate on that kind of shaming in light of the protest, in light of the resistance that the protagonist is displaying?
Kind of take on this moral stance, saying, why is she doing something like this? Has she no shame? Isn't there another way to get out of it? You know, not taking into consideration the fact that this is the only weapon at hand that she can, use. And she also tells them that. She turns around and tells the other women that this is my only hope. Otherwise, I would have my head split against something and, never recover. And one has to keep in mind the fact that the next day she has to go to work. She has to kind of stand up. Another thing, women, yes, they have to. They have to contend sometimes. Sometimes there is a united front. For example, if you were to read Vanma, upper caste landlords. So this is again born out of an incident that actually happened in Bama's, the village neighboring Bama's own. And there, of course, you have these policemen rounding up people, irrespective of whether they had any part to play in the rioting or not. The corpses back from the bazaars and conduct a burial on their own. Some of them who have been rounded up by the police actually stand and reason with the policemen. Of course, they are kicked in the, one of them who's, pregnant is kicked by the policeman and she loses her baby and things like that. But they are capable. I mean, sometimes here you have the case of them all standing together because it's a shared loss, a shared sense of loss. And that is what really kind of brings them to a detailed way of, she puts down what really Bama is in favor of herself. Thank you. Yeah.
Okay, so I'm going to be a bit provocative here. So this is actually an open question to both of you. From what both of you have said, it kind of reminds me or resonates with a lot of debates, even in black race studies and black, race feminism, and the problems that are involved in trying to articulate gender and caste at once, right? I mean, because there's always this impulse to try and privilege one over the other, right? What does it mean to actually try and articulate both and emphasize both equally, right? So, I think one problem that seems to emerge in both your papers is really the question of not woman, but really the question of femininity, right? What does it mean to be feminine? Because I think there is this, at best, ambiguous, if not, and at worst, a hostile reaction to what it means to be feminine, right? And that seems to be the problem, right? So what does it mean to be feminine? What does it mean to be a non-conventional man, right? Because this whole act of shaming, of saying, you have a mustache, but you aren't an adequate man, right? Or to lift your sari up in a very, kind of resonates with even the way hijras shame men generally, right? How are you shaming them? You're actually showing them your private parts, right? Your genitals or your mutilated genitals, or what exactly are you doing? I mean, there seems to be this whole specter, this whole horror, this disgust, this deploying of femininity, as it were, right? But there's a certain great discomfort with it at the same time, right? It's not always empowering. It's very ambiguous, right? So, I mean, how exactly are you, or do you think these narratives or your papers are actually complicating what it means to be Dalit and what it means to be woman, or what it means to be feminine, right? Because, very few narratives actually try and complicate just that, right? I mean, of course, it's important to talk about the problems of Dalit men. What it means to be masculine, what it means to be Dalit feminine, Dalit masculine, which may not map onto man and woman at all. But is not necessarily reducible to a man or masculinity, right? So not reducing someone to being either Dalit or masculine or feminine or whatever.
Yeah.
That's important.
Gradual, steady effeminization or experiences of effeminization as this man fails to live up to certain kind of ideals. And here I have focused on the public sphere the public sphere, more specifically, where certain kind of masculinity is required and enactment of certain kind of what those norms which are considered to be masculine, those enactments are required. So from my paper, what I've gathered is that the question of caste and caste transgressions are played out through these, you know, through the questionings of masculinities and femininities that work in their lives. So, and that you are saying that we should complicate these, what it means to be a feminine and what it means to be masculine, and that is what I was exactly trying to do. Probably, I don't know whether it has come up in my paper, but and even in like other conferences where there's a lot of focus on masculinity and femininity.
What I know is that it's a collection of Baba Saheb Ambedkar's writings, and with a 43-page introduction by Rege. So that was the first question, which is like whether you have mentioned Ambedkar's work or not, but that was actually the introduction of Ambedkar's work. So that clarification, I just wanted to know.